Hallelujah. Come on, let's lift up the name of Jesus. Can somebody just shout his name? Say Jesus.
Jesus.
Come on, who woke us up this morning? Say Jesus.
Jesus.
Come on, give him praise right here, right now. Hallelujah. Come on, put your hands together. Let's glorify the name of Jesus. He is worthy of all the praise. He's worthy of all the glory. And he's worthy of all the honor. Come on, shout his name in his face. Hey. Clap your hands. Hey. Come on, come on, come on. Come on.
May you please bow your head. Dear Lord, thank you for opening my eyes to see a new day. Thank you for our families. Thank you for all the beautiful people in the world. And thank you for giving us life and light. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us for our trespasses as we forgive them that trespass against us. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Come on, all over the church, somebody shout Yahweh. Yahweh, Yahweh. Come on, somebody shout Yahweh. Yahweh be praised. Now we want some crowd participation. It says, oh, Yahweh, Yahweh, be praised, Yahweh. All over the house say, Yahweh. And reigns with splendor, our God. His name is Yahweh. Hey. He's sovereign King and full of wonder, our God. You say,
Yahweh.
Everybody sing Yahweh. Matchless power, infinite wisdom, our God, you say,
Yahweh.
Oh, no one can describe him, no one can compare to him, our God, you say, Yahweh.
Yahweh.
Oh, Yahweh.
Yahweh.
Yahweh. Yahweh. Say,
be praised.
Yahweh.
Yahweh.
Oh, the kingdom, yours is the power, our God, you say Yahweh.
Yahweh,
be all the glory now and forever, our God, you say Yahweh.
Yahweh.
Everybody lift it up and say
Yahweh.
Yahweh,
Yahweh.
Yahweh.
Be praised,
Yahweh.
Yeah.
get the glory. Everybody say, you get the glory.
You get the glory.
Come on and say, you get the glory.
You get the glory.
Hey, say, you get the glory.
You get
come
the
on.
Glory.
No matter what you're going through, he will continue to get the
you
glory.
Get the glory.
Yours is the kingdom, yours is the power, our God, you say
Yahweh.
Beyond the glory, our God, you say
Yahweh.
Not church, say Yahweh. Church say
Yahweh,
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 be praised,
be praised,
Yahweh,
Yahweh,
hallelujah.
Please stand for the word of, please stand for the reading of the word. The next day, the huge crowd that had arrived for the feast heard that Jesus was entering Jerusalem. They broke off palm branches and went out to meet him, and they cheered, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in God's name. Yes, the King of Israel. Jesus got a young donkey and rode it, just as the scripture has it. No fear, daughter Zion. See how your king comes, riding a donkey colt. The disciples didn't notice the fulfillment of many scriptures at the time, but after Jesus was glorified, they remembered what was written about him. Matched what was done to him. For the word of the Lord, for the people of God, amen.
Amen.
Amen. You get the glory. Say you get the glory.
You get the glory.
Come on, give him the glory with the waving of your palms today.
Ooh.
Hosanna. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And we glorify the Lord and we magnify. Come on, you say Yahweh, Yahweh, sing.
Yahweh, Yahweh.
Come on, say, Philip, you try. Come on, say, Yahweh, say. Come on, sing it again, Yahweh. Come on, it sounds beautiful. Come on, keep singing. Come on, sing, Yahweh, sing. Can't you see him riding in? Riding into the city. As they were placing their cloaks on the ground. And they were singing, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Come all over the building, Yahweh, sing.
Yahweh.
Music. Come on, I want to hear you sing. Come on, lift it up today. Come on, sing Yahweh. Sing. Come on and lift them up, St. Philip. Come on, lift them up, St. Philip. Magnify the name of the Lord. For the Lord is great and greatly to be praised. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there is something about that name. There is something about that name. So lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, that the King of glory shall come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. He is the King of glory. And we give you all the glory. We worship you, our Lord. For you are worthy to be praised. And we give you all the glory. And we worship you, our Lord. For you are worthy to be praised. And we give you all the glory. We worship you, our Lord. For you are worthy to be praised. Come on, don't get tired this morning. If he's a healer, come on and wave those palm branches. If he's a waymaker, come on and wave those palm branches. Is he a door opener? Come on and wave those branches today. Hallelujah. God is worthy. He is worthy to be praised. And we honor him. And we glorify him. You may be seated in the very presence of the Lord. I greet you this morning in the love and joy that is found in our Savior. Our Savior, Jesus the Christ, who we don't mind praising every single chance we get. The Lord has been embarrassingly kind to us, and we ought to give God praise. And if you don't praise him, the rocks will cry out. And if you don't praise him, the rocks will cry out. And if you don't praise him, either way, the name of the Lord will be praised with the crashing of the ocean, with the song of the birds, with the joy of the lilies of the field, the name of the Lord indeed will be praised. Yes, and the Lord is worthy. I greet you this morning in love. We're so glad that you're here worshiping with us this morning, whether you're in person or online. It is amazing, a wonderful day to be in the house of the Lord one more time. I want you all to join us on our prayer call again tomorrow. Yes, it is Holy Week. And come on, clap your hands for that Holy Week. And I want you to join us on our prayer call tomorrow night. We'll be covering not only you in intercessory prayer, but we'll be covering our entire week as we have a week full of activities here at St. Philip. And I want you to come on and join us as we walk through this week of services. I believe they're going to be a blessing. This is our version of the Super Bowl. Amen. Christians ought to be celebrating every single chance we get. We certainly ought to be celebrating during Holy Week, and I want you to come out and indeed be a part of it. Again, this Wednesday, join us. We'll be in the flag for our midweek service. Bishop William Murphy will be in the building for our intercessory prayer conference. Amen. I just believe God is going to do something special through Bishop Murphy. I believe it. I feel it in my bones that his ministry is going to be phenomenal in this place. I know it. Not only because he's a phenomenal anointed man of God, but because we were supposed to have this conference before, had to do some postponing, and he's back, and I just believe the power of God will be double of what it was going to be the last time. So I don't want you to miss this Wednesday night. It's going to be amazing. And then Thursday night, Monday, Thursday, we'll celebrate the Lord's Supper as well as we'll celebrate foot washing this Thursday, Monday, Thursday. It's going to be an amazing time as well. Dr. Allison Henderson Brooks will be our guest preacher. Not only is she a pastor, but she's also dean of students over at Candler School of Theology. And I'm so blessed that she's going to come and just bless our socks off this week and Monday, Thursday. Bring the family to be a part of that service as well as we take our Holy Communion together during Holy Week on Monday, Thursday, and again participate in foot washing. And then Friday, yes, Good Friday, we're going to have an amazing time yet again on Good Friday, the seven last words of Jesus Christ from the cross. I told y'all I want to be clear. I'm putting out the clarion call. Do not let our church, I said, outnumber St. Philip in that service on Good Friday at 12 noon. I'm telling you, seven of the Lord's preachers will be here, and I'm excited about it. Dr. Tony Alvarado, Reverend Sharonda Williams, Reverend Octavia Smith, Dr. William Flippin, Dr. Eric Lee, Dr. Cynthia Hale, Dr. Kerwin Lee, awesome men and women of God, and I believe we're going to be blessed in a beautiful and wonderful way. That's going to be great. And I also want you to know that we are prepared for you for Resurrection Sunday, Atlanta Alive. Yes, that's next Sunday, 9:30 a.m. I need all of you. I'm talking about, I need Pookie, Ray Ray, Junior, Pot Liquor, everybody. I need everybody in church next week. I need everybody in church next week. Get everybody. Praise the Lord. Those folks that only come once a year, this is your time. Amen. I need to see lavender suits, lavender socks, and lavender shoes, brothers. Y'all know how we do. Y'all know I need to see it all. Amen. I want you to get a lavender hat and some lavender cufflinks. Come on to worship next Sunday. It's going. Y'all know how we do. Get your Stacey Adams shined up, brothers. But next Sunday is going to be amazing. I want you to come out. We have extra parking all around. Our neighboring community and the neighboring businesses have agreed to allow St. Philip to park in their parking lots during the service. We have more information about that coming up this week, but I want you to come out and be a part of it as we celebrate the risen Savior. And the old saints used to say, God's not dead, yet alive. Feel him in my hands, feel him in my feet, feel him all over me. And of course, our photographer guild will be there to make sure you can have your family portraits next Sunday as well. They'll be there in the flag to make sure you can take your pictures with your family next week. Also, yeah, y'all know, immediately after worship today, we'll be over with our young people in the flag for their resurrection celebration program. Come on, clap it up for our young people. They have been preparing. They have been preparing. And we are excited about all that our young people will bless us with. And I want all of you to come out and be a part of that as well in the 3G Cafe immediately following worship today. Also, the sneaker ball is coming up. Yes, our seniors and retirees want you to know that on Friday, April the 12th at 6 o'clock p.m., the sneaker ball is on the way. Tickets are only $35, and they will be on sale after worship today. Please see a member of that community. Definitely Sister Betty Richardson Brown, who's the chair of that event. For more information, please be a part of that indeed. Amen. It's Palm Sunday. Come on, wave those palms one more time. Let's see you wave those palms one more time. Yes, we kick off a wonderful, fantastic week in the Lord, and I want all of you to indeed be a part of every single thing that God is going to do. The 3G Cafe will be on and popping next week as well. Ham, turkey, green beans, mashed potatoes, and gravy, and all the fixings next week. Amen. Come out and be a part of that as well. And then, this is my last announcement for today. Amen. Be reminded about, also, there is another morning meditation prayer call that has been going on for about 12 or 13 years here at St. Philip, and they are on that call every single morning at 6 o'clock a.m. Praise the Lord, 6 o'clock a.m. Come on, clap your hands for them, yes. Because I don't even know what that looked like. What does 6 o'clock in the morning look like? Amen. But shout out to them for being on that call and keeping it going. And if you want to be a part of that call, you can dial in, amen, 667-770-1524 to be a part of that call every morning. Now, some of you all that are on your way to work or your teachers or whatever you do, you can jump on that call and they'll be glad to pray with you in the morning. Amen. Now, where are our guests? This is your first time worshiping with us here at St. Philip. Come on, stand. Let us see where you are. If this is your very first time being here, we want to welcome you to St. Philip properly. Amen. Yes. Come on, make some noise for the first time guests. I mean, we're so glad to see y'all today. You all have put a smile on my face today. Come on, St. Philip, make some noise for the first time guests. Praise the Lord. Now I want y'all to attack them this morning. Y'all attack them. I want y'all to give them good hugs, good long hugs. Hold them and ask them, do they need a church home? Tell them St. Philip is the place to be. Come on, stand to your feet all over. Greet somebody around you with a handshake and a hug.
Welcome to St. Philip, where the people.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Amen. Continue this with our young people immediately following service over in the flat. Amen. They would love to see you there with them this morning. Amen. What time is it, St. Philip? It's giving time in St. Philip. It's giving time. Amen. Praise the Lord. See, that's what I'm talking about. You need to be excited about giving, excited about sowing seed. Excited that God has literally given seed to the sower. Amen. It could be another way. It could be another way. But I'm blessed to be a blessing. Amen. Blessed to be a blessing. God has just given us a spirit of generosity that causes us to sow seed every single chance that we get. I don't look for reasons not to give. I look for reasons to give. Amen. God has been so embarrassingly kind and just wonderful. And I try to sow seed every single chance I get. not just in the worship experience, but I try to sow seed into the lives of others. I try to be a good tipper when I go out to restaurants. Amen. Church got quiet. Amen. Church got quiet. Try to be a good tipper to the man handling my luggage at the hotel. And every now and again, you know, even though I was driving up the street here on Candler Road on Memorial Drive a couple of weeks ago, and there were some brothers out there. They were selling some water, some Gatorade, you know, them young men. And I made a mistake of having $10. And I guess I didn't know the rules of engagement, because I rolled my window down and I gave one of them $10. And about five of them almost jumped through my window. I said, I only need one water, bro. Why you ain't split that up? You should have split that up. I'm sorry, guys. I'm sorry. I believe we ought to be generous. I really believe that. You would be surprised at how many people could use $10. Look at your blessed self. You don't even know what that looks like. But you would be surprised how many people would just be blessed by $10. If you just took $10 and sold it to them, that would bless them. And here you are living off more than enough. You can right now live off your interest and be just fine. And there are some people who would just hurt themselves to be halfway where you are. So I want us to be generous every chance we get. Every giving opportunity we have, I want us to be generous. I want you to sow extra seed today for taking care of the Temple TCT. If you can, I want you to join me in sowing a seed, a $50 seed, in taking care of the Temple today. If you can add that to your giving today. The team here at St. Philip has been working diligently trying to get ready for Resurrection Sunday. They've been working, cleaning, shining floors, changing light bulbs, cutting down trees. They've been doing the extra to make sure that we are presented well as worshipers come, as guests come and worship with us. I'm telling you, they will come as guests, but they'll leave as family. And we want them to feel welcome when they come through the doors of St. Philip. So if you can and if you will, if you have an extra seed to sow today, I'm asking that you would join me in doing that today for TCT, taking care of the temple. It's there on your giving apparatus. It's there. If you're going to do it any other way, you can just put it in the memo or the notes section, TCT. We'll be so blessed because of you. We give via Givelify. We give Cash App. We give Text to Give. You also give by mailing it in, 240 Candler Road, Atlanta, Georgia, 30317. Those of you that are worshiping with us online, YouTube, Facebook, on our website, you all can join us in giving today. We want you all to have an anointed experience as well. I pray that all the time. I want the anointing of God to not just bless us here in the main sanctuary, but I want the anointing of God to go through computer screens and phones and televisions, however we're watching from all over the country. We're a blessed place, St. Philip. I'm here to tell you, I don't go very many places without people telling me I watch you all every single Sunday. I traveled to the metropolis of Americus, Georgia this week. And I was stopped several times by many of my colleagues saying, Pastor Elwood, we enjoy the worship experience at St. Philip. Amen. We are blessed people. There's nothing wrong with being blessed and walking in the blessings of the Almighty God. I'm going to pray over your seed. I want you to do the exact same thing. I'm telling you, never, ever, ever give a seed, no matter when you give it, never give it without praying over it first. There is something amazing happens when you trust God with whatever you have. God gives you more than enough. God, thank you. We consider it an honor and a sheer privilege to have seed to sow. You're kind to us. You're beautiful to us. You are amazing to us. And we thank you for it today, God. There is no giving opportunity that we won't take advantage of. For God, you've blessed us to be a blessing. You've blessed us with generosity. You've put it in our hearts and our minds, oh God. And we thank you, God. Now, God, as we give, God, know that it comes directly from our hearts, the tithe, the offering over and above the tithe. Whatever we give, God, it comes directly from our hearts. We are accountable. We are responsible. God, we give because we are generous and we love you. It is in the strong name of Jesus the Christ we pray, and every believer in God said, amen. Come on, St. Philip, let's give together. If you're online, come on, let's give as well.
Hosanna,
Hosanna,
Hosanna.
Look at our babies in the back there. Come on.
Hosanna.
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 Give it up to him one more time. I want y'all to make some noise for Tristan this morning. Yeah. And give it up to these babies in the choir back there. Y'all didn't see my girl in the green. Praise the Lord. Amen. They gotta go get ready for the rest of their day, and I want you to join them. Amen. I also want to let you know it's a full week. Saturday morning, that's the 30th, the day before Resurrection Sunday, at 10 o'clock a.m. we will have drive-through prayer. All right, drive-through prayer. You can drive in on Candler Road. We'll pray with you. Our team will pray with you. You can drive right back out. Amen. But we're going to open it up to an entire community. Amen. We're going to open it up to the community. I want everybody to come. You all can come. You all can invite somebody to come. That's going to be great. I have these songs. It was funny. You know, you've been in church. I've been in church all my life. All my life, and there are certain songs that you're used to singing and used to hearing on particular days. And I know there are some songs St. Philip used to hearing, praise the Lord, Good Friday, Maundy Thursday, and Resurrection Sunday. We're gonna hit them all. I'm telling you, we're gonna hit them all. We're gonna hit each and every single one. But I was thinking about this one this morning. I was on my way to church.
By the Lord. For he is worthy to be praised. Come on, sing,
oh.
Oh, my salvation.
time sing Hosanna, Hosanna.
Hosanna.
Come on, stand to your feet all over the sanctuary. I know that in this season that all of us are believing God for something. And the thing is, you're holding it in too long and you're keeping too much to yourself. Just a moment. I want you to turn and tell somebody one thing that you believe in God for. Go ahead, right quick, right quick. Now the person that you told it to, I want you to go ahead and start giving God praise for him like it's already done. Come on, give God praise like you know it's already done. Matter of fact, go ahead and give him a wave like it's already done. I can already see it happening. I know it's already done. I know it's already done. I promise I'm a move, but can you give God another 10 more seconds like it's already done? Oh, have mercy. See, that's the ones that's for real believing God for something right there. They can't cut it loose that fast. They just... Repeat these words after me. Lord, if it's not my day, may it be for someone that's close to me. I pray that you would bless my neighbor with signs, wonders, and miracles. May their testimony be great, and may your name be praised in Jesus' name. And the people of God said amen. One more time. Come on, St. Philip. Yeah. You may be seated in God's presence. The Interdenominational Theological Center, a place that I love, a place that many of us love, used to hold conference on ministry when I was a student at the greatest institution this side of heaven, Bethune-Cookman. And they would have conference on ministry here in Atlanta, and I came up one year. Dr. Quentin Robinson gave me a cassette of a preacher. Y'all know what a cassette is? Some young person leaned over and said, "A what?" Cassette of a preacher. Y'all remember when the tape ministry used to be amazing, right? What they say, a cassette. I know I said it wrong, a cassette. Used to be amazing. Used to have 50 duplicators going on at the same time. This particular preacher was preaching at Ben Hill United Methodist Church for Dr. McAllister Hollins at that time. And when I heard the tape, they told me this was Dr. Carolyn Knight. She was the homiletics professor at the ITC. And I knew right then, my mind was made up that not only was I going to ITC, but I had to sit at the feet of this preacher, an amazing woman of God. Dr. Knight is special. She's one of God's best. God has blessed her with an amazing, not only gift, but one thing she's always on our case about is not only having the gift, but working on the craft to make it better. She believes in the art and science of preaching. She also believes in the power of prayer. She has preached at all of the major conferences and all of the major churches around the country. If I list her friends and her colleagues and those that not only mentored her, but those that she also mentors, the list would be way too long. She is powerful, and she is a true walking, living, breathing, moving testimony. Yeah. Yeah, y'all remember Dr. Clay Evans had this song, say, if you want to see a miracle, just look at me. That's part of Dr. Knight's testimony. Living, breathing, moving witness that God is not only a healer, but you know, we like to preach that that same power that got Jesus up, same power that raises all of us up. I took all of my preaching classes from Dr. Knight, every single one of them I took from Dr. Knight, homiletics one, homiletics two, and women's ways of preaching, which was an elective class that gave a very keen insight on the nature of being a woman in ministry and what it meant for women to preach. And y'all were like, well, what were you doing in that class? It was women's ways of preaching. Me, was there gonna be some women in the class? No, that's not what I mean. No, I wanted to get a different perspective, and actually the spawn of the message that I preached last week in its original form actually came from that class, The Right to Remain Silent. I'm glad that this preacher's here. She's a major, major Denver Broncos fan. she keeps us going every single chance that she gets. I'm glad that she's here. I am proud to present her to be our preacher. She's part of our family here. Y'all have heard her before. Amen. She's no stranger to St. Philip. I want you, and I'm telling you, every single chance you have to be and see and be a witness to a miracle, you ought to celebrate God for it. Anybody that God has ever healed, you are a miracle. The Bible talks about you. You're a miracle. So I want y'all to receive this preacher today in love. And that the choir will have ministered one more time. The very next voice you will hear will be that of Dr. Carolyn Ann Knight. Receive her by saying amen.
We'll bow down and say you are God. Every man will bow down and say you are King. So let's start right now. Why would we wait? King of glory, fill this place. I just wanna be with you. I just wanna be with you. Just wanna be with you. Yes, the world,
yes, the world
will bow down,
bow down and say you are God. Every man
will
bow down and say you are King.
So let's start right now.
So let's start right now.
Why would we
wait?
until you come again. We will sing hallelujah until you come again. And we will dance in your presence until
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, to God be the glory for the great things that God has done, for this is a day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the, oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. If you are excited about what God has already done, is doing, and will do, why don't you put your hands together and give God your best? Sunday morning, March the 24th, praise. I'll wait. I'm waiting on your best praise. 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 Hallelujah. How good our God is, and we magnify him in this place. You may have your seats in the presence of our God for just a moment. Certainly to the esteemed and honored and revered pastor of the St. Philip AME Church, my dear friend and brother, the Reverend Dr. Anton Elwood, and to Reverend Lady Williams and Elwood, and to the Elwood family, and to the ministers who are here, and to all of those who are a part of this singing aggregation, certainly to these young people who have blessed us so richly during this worship encounter, to the officers, lay leaders, and servant leaders of this marvelous congregation, to those who serve today in the ministry of security and hospitality, to all of you who walk by faith, my brothers and sisters in Christ and in creation, ladies and gentlemen, it is good to be here, for this is another day that God has blessed us to be in the land of the dying on our way to the land of the living. And we thank and praise God on this glorious Palm Sunday 2024. Let me take just a moment again to always express my kindness and love for this congregation, the St. Philip AME Church. Wherever I am, you all are with me. And I thank and praise God for you. This church has prayed me through and stayed me through. And I thank and praise God for you. COVID has somewhat eased, and I'm not here as much as I'd like, but wherever I am, I take St. Philip with me. I thank and praise God for this church. Let me also say that only those of us who teach and have students will know what it feels like to have one of your students and your students' entire family standing in this place. The first two times I came and saw him and Lady Elwood in this place, it was just really, really too emotional. But I thank and praise God. But every time I leave, I also tell God this. I said, you know, God, you and me are good. Because I can look and point at some pulpits where some preachers are going to be preaching the gospel long after I'm gone. So when I get there, I don't want any trouble getting in. Because if I have any trouble, I'm just going to play. I'm going to say, look at Dr. Elwood. I'm going to say, you know, that's one of mine, Doc. That's one of mine. Let me in. So I thank and praise God that St. Philip is in good hands. And he's a marvelous man of God, a marvelous preacher, a marvelous, marvelous prayer warrior. And I thank and praise God for him. His sister, his wife is a twin, you know. And I had all of them in class. And the twins, I don't know if it was intentional, but they really got me, because one of them took my class one semester and passed it, and I thought I was through with her. And then she showed up the next year. I said, what are you doing? And then she explained to me that she was a twin. And that was my first hearing of it. So it took me a while to wrap my head around them. But I had them all, and they were a blessing. And now they are a blessing to the kingdom of God and the body of Christ. How we thank and praise God for the Elwood family. Turn with me in your Bibles to the Gospels recorded by Luke. The 19th chapter, verses 28 through 40. Luke, the 19th chapter, verses 28 through 40. When you find it on your device or in your Bible, in the sofa or in the sanctuary, say amen. And when he had entered, he said these things. He went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. And when he drew near to Bethany and Bethany at the mount that is called Olivet, he sent two of his disciples, saying, "Go into the village in front of you, where on entering you will find a colt tied, on which no one has ever yet sat. A young colt, untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks why you are untying it, you shall say this: the Lord has need of it." So those who were sent went away and found it just as he told them. And as they were untying the colt, the owners of it said to them, "Why are you untying it?" And they said, "The Lord has need of it." And they brought it to Jesus, throwing their cloaks on the colt. They set Jesus on it. And as he rode along, they spread their cloaks on the road. As he was drawing near, already on the way down the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of his disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest." And some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." He answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out." Glory be to God, and to God's Son, and to God's precious Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. For the time that is ours in this 9:30 a.m. worship encounter in observance of Palm Sunday 2024, I want to request your attention as I preach from the subject, God's side or the other side. God's side or the other side. The last time that I checked, some 2 weeks ago, almost 65 people had viewed the conversation that I believe had something for everybody. It is still trending and being discussed and debated on all social media platforms. To be honest, it took me 3 attempts to watch it. Initially, when my friend at the gym told me that I must see it, I went home and immediately began to stream it on YouTube television. The opening, with a toast and a discussion about brown liquor, made me prematurely conclude that this conversation was not for me. The next day, when I told my friend at the gym, he urged me to give it another try. Round 2. This time, at some point during the interview, I was simply overtaken by sleep. But I was not to be denied, and the third time was a charm. I was able to get through all 2 hours and 46 minutes and 8 seconds of the interview between former Denver Bronco MVP, now turned sports journalist, podcast host Shannon Sharp, and comedian Michael Williams. It was an interesting talk indeed. It was informative, it was revealing, it was candid, it contained much fiction and nonfiction. It made me extremely grateful that my name was not Steve or Cedric or Ricky or Kevin or Tiffany or Monique or Oprah, While I am being transparent and honest by admitting that I watched the entire interview, it is not my intention or desire to critique or analyze or review the conversation. However, I am going to admit that I personally learned a great deal. Again, I'm not going to use Palm Sunday to do a deep dive into the interview because even though I am being honest and candid and admitting that I viewed it, you all are acting like you didn't, but I know that you did, and I know that I'm not the only one who viewed it. But I was impressed when Cat Williams said that the truth doesn't need motivation. I heard him when he said that he leaves a tithe and feeds the hungry in every city where he performs. I said to myself, Carolyn, you have to increase your reading habits by a large measure because Cat Williams said that he reads 3,000 books a year. But for me, the most profound and prolific and powerful point in the interview came at 16 minutes and 2 seconds when Cat Williams said this, and I quote, race is not the line where the line is drawn. It is either God's side or the other side. And we don't care about the other side. Now, I'm not sure that I agree with the entirety of what he said about race. I believe that race is an issue where lines are always drawn, or what he said after that. I think that discussions about race are needed and necessary and should be ongoing because race in this nation is something that we are still working through and we still have some issues and race is still critical and we should be concerned and show a measure of empathy for everyone that we know. But when Kat said, it's God's side or the other side, Kat had my attention. Why? Because I believe that in times like these, in this broken, divided, and fractured world that we are living in, it's time for the people of God to know and declare where they stand. If we are serious about saving this nation, impacting our community, turning this world around, if we are serious about keeping people in the church and getting people to the church and getting people to come back to the church, we have to be clear about this. You're either on God's side or you're on the other side. Can I push it? I do not know if this was his intention, but I do believe that Micah Cat Williams was cautioning the church and warning those of us in the church about the danger and damage of neutrality, indifference, and indecision in these difficult days. In a time like this, the worst place in the world for the church to be is hung up between two sides. This is not a day for the people of God to be behind the curtain, hanging out backstage. This is not a day to be silent and absent. Whether he meant to or not, I heard Brother Williams saying that in a world like this, you have to know whose side you are on. We know because the text and the historical record tells us that the arrival of Jesus in Jerusalem was met with much anticipation and controversy. All four of the Gospels record this event as taking place during the time of Passover, the Jewish High Holy Day. At that time of year, the town's population grew exponentially from 40,000 to almost 300,000 people. The residents and neighbors of Jerusalem had to share the streets, inns, and cafes with visitors from the surrounding regions. This was a crowd in the vicinity when this itinerant preacher and his handful of disciples arrived in town. Palm Sunday is interesting on the church calendar. It is an interesting day in the life of the church because we're not really sure what we're supposed to do, how we're supposed to feel, given the events that will take place just a few days from now. To be sure, the time of cruel crucifixion has been set. A sham trial and the mockery of the soldiers, the taste of bitter vinegar and betrayal await Jesus Christ. Jesus has set his face towards Calvary. But on this day, the sight of Jesus riding into town on a donkey created a spontaneous and extemporaneous outburst from the crowd. Marcus J. Borg and John Dominic Crossman, in their book The Last Week, that documents with great detail the final days of Jesus, report that there were at least three different crowds on that day. Yeah, three different crowds that compromised that large crowd on that day. Yeah. There were the disciples of Jesus, followers of Jesus, believers of Jesus, who saw him and it caused them to praise God. There were the religious leaders who had the responsibility of keeping a record of who was in town in order to receive the temple tax. There were the political leaders who were expected to show up at the time of year and collect the required revenue. Then there was just a crowd of people who just showed up. They responded to the text blast and became a part of the flash mob. This crowd wanted to make sure that they did not miss the event. They wanted to be sure that they captured the moment on Facebook Live, did a TikTok video, posted on the gram. When their friend shot them a text saying, "What's up?" They wanted to be able to respond, "Nothing. Just down here hanging out in Jerusalem for a few." And can I suggest this morning that in a world like this, in a time like this, in a day like this, you don't want to just be in the crowd. In fact, you cannot just be in the crowd. If you're in the crowd, you're on somebody's side. These people have seen the ministry of Jesus, been the recipient of some of the miracles of Jesus, heard the message of Jesus, were acquainted with a man called Jesus, and still they wouldn't decide whose side they were on. They just wanted to hang out and hide in the crowd. May I remind you of the words of Cat Williams? It's either God's side or the other side. Perhaps the people in that crowd were like many of us are today. Yeah, we find it difficult to choose sides because we're too overwhelmed by life and circumstances, worn out and worn down by a never-ending cycle of social media and cable news blitz. Perhaps they were frustrated and exhausted from the pandemic, the resurgence of racism, misogyny, patriarchy, gender bias, and violence, sexual and mental abuse, erasure, and exploitation. Perhaps they did not have the strength to confront the religious and political leaders. There were persons in that crowd that day, like there are in our day, who could not and would not make a decision. They wanted to be in the crowd, but not a part of the crowd. They found it hard to choose sides. They were like people who asked them, when you ask them who they are rooting for, in in March Madness, their response is, I don't care who wins. Really? You're going to watch every game? You're going to fill out a bracket? And you still can't decide who you want to win? Surrounded by the disciples of Jesus, the political and religious leaders, Jesus in the midst of it all, and they could not decide. Well, the people like back then are like the people today. Yeah, with all that we know about God, all that God has seen us through, brought us through, and kept us through, with all that God has provided, prevented, and promised, with all that God has done, is doing, and will do, there are those of us who just want to hang out in the crowd. We still want to just be able to mark on X that we were part of the crowd. There are still those of us who prefer the other side to God's side. For some of us, as soon as God doesn't give us what we want, how we wanted it, when we wanted it, we get in a hurry and move to the other side. Now, I'm not suggesting that it's all bad on the other side, nor am I suggesting that we should always be us versus them. But I am suggesting that you should be clear about what side you're on and why. You should be clear about who you're hanging around, mingling with, and why. We are in this world, but we are not of this world. To be sure, there will be times when we must collaborate, cooperate, and form coalitions with persons who don't have our worldview, our particular outlook, who don't talk or think or behave the way that we do. But when we go into these places and spaces and nurture these relationships, it is to have influence and impact and to make a difference. I'm a fierce competitor. I always want to be on the winning side. I may not win every race or pass every test, but I'm going to compete to the best of my ability. My competitive nature is one of the reasons that I made up my mind to be on God's side. When I look back over my life and see the totality of all that God has done for me, of all that God has brought me through, I'm convinced without a shadow of a doubt that the God I love and serve is a winner. And when the smoke clears, when the dust settles, when it comes out in the final wrench, no matter the situation, I'm going to have the victory. I've seen God do the miraculous on his side, and I've decided to stay with God because sooner or later, things work in my favor. God turns it around for me. Being on God's side doesn't require perfection. That blesses me tremendously. What about you? When I'm on God's side, I don't have to be perfect. I just have to be faithful. Being on God's side requires that I hold on, that I hold out, that I hold up. Being on God's side requires that I treat people right, that I do the right thing, that I love the best I can, that I stand for the poor and the oppressed, that I fight for righteous causes, that I fight for those who cannot fight for themselves, that I know the truth when I hear it. Being on God's side doesn't require that I have it to together, or can keep it all together, or even get it together. It doesn't require that every T of my life is crossed, every I is dotted, every comma be in place. Being on God's side doesn't require that I win every race, make every goal, score every point. Being on God's side doesn't require that I always have a smile on my face, or a spring in my step, or a song in my heart. Being on God's side means that you will know the truth when you hear it, that you will give life your best shot, do the best you know how to do, stand for what is right, defend the least of these, the left out and the looked over, help whenever needed, serve when required, give what you can, lift your voice and sing, light a candle in the darkness. And I need to pause right here on my way to my conclusion and say, not parenthetically, but essentially, in these brutal and blistering and bitter days of conflict, chaos, and confusion, when the world is on the brink of World War III, and there is so much talk of a modern day civil war and unrest, people threatening a bloodbath in the streets of our cities, in the face of radical evil, division and dysfunction in the government, mixed messaging in the church, there's a very real threat to the quality of life and existence hanging over our heads. Daily, when we consider that for almost 10 years now, we've had nothing but unending, ongoing turmoil and trouble. We've gone from COVID to confusion, to conflict, to chaos, to COVID 2.0. I do not understand people who just want to hang out in the crowd. I do not understand people who want to be indifferent and indecisive. I do not understand people who choose neutrality as an option. Politically, I know that the choices that we are facing on both sides are not great. Speaking for myself, I believe that we deserve better. But since the choice is between an old honest man and an old dishonest man, I'm going with the old honest man. If the choice is between an old man who knows the Bible and has been inside of the church and has read a constitution, and an old man who stands in front of the church while holding the Bible upside down and wants to destroy the constitution, I'm going with the Bible reading, old man. I may not be completely satisfied with the choices that I have, but I'm going with the old man who does not have a mugshot. Spiritually, it's time to decide. If you're able, you need to be willing to make your way back to the house of God, back to the house of prayer, back to the house of worship. Mentally and emotionally, it's time to decide. Granted, these are difficult days. These are the days of our life. All of God's children need to make the most of these days. These days are difficult, but they're all that we have right now. So if not now, when? This is your moment to make a contribution, to make a move, to be truly influenced. We live in a world where every day people are taking sides. The division in this nation that is tearing this nation apart, reaping its very fragile seams apart, is a result of people taking taking sides. You're either saved or unsaved. AME or Baptist, Democrat or Republican, conservative or liberal, traditional or progressive. And you may not agree, but I came to tell you anyway, whether you realize it or not, whether you like it or not, you're already on somebody's side. Right or wrong, good or evil, truth or lie, just or unjust. Jesus said something about sides when he spoke about sheep and goat, wheat and tare, light and darkness, the righteous and the unrighteous. You're either on God's side or you're on the other side. And you know what I have discovered and recently, just in recent days, and this text reveals that you can be in the church, a preacher in the church, a leader in the convention. You can call yourself a whole convention of churches and be on the other side. There are innocent people in Gaza who since October 7th, 2023, have been struggling daily to survive. Almost 30 Palestinians, 45% of which are children and youth, have already been killed and separated from their family. There are hostages being held whose families don't know if they are dead or alive. There's an ongoing crisis at the border. African Americans are still not safe in the school, the store, or the sanctuary. There's still no real gun control legislation in this nation. Women cannot make life-affirming reproductive decisions for themselves and the children they must carry without the influence and interference of elderly white men. This nation was founded by immigrants, built by immigrants, and is sustained by immigrants. And yet states like Florida, Utah, Texas, and Alabama are fighting against diversity, equity, and inclusion. We are facing the most critical election of our lifetime in just a few months, and some black churches are still hung up on whether or not a woman should be allowed to preach. Boy, bye. To be sure, to be on God's side is about God's business. Make no mistake about it, we have some very difficult days ahead. Artificial intelligence is being called and viewed as an existential threat to humanity. We have been sailing for some time now in uncharted territory. We're not sure how this thing is going to turn out in November, but we do know what it's looking like right now, and it's not looking pretty. People of God, God's business is serious business, and we need to get serious about doing God's business. Can I say it like I'm feeling it? We have a serious assignment to love and encourage everyone. Not just our kindred and tribe, everyone. We have a mandate to show the love of God to Jesus. And we have a serious assignment to win the lost, feed the hungry, give hope to the hopeless and the helpless, to give sight to the spiritually and emotionally blind, to set the captives free. In order to do that, we have to start taking our message and our mission seriously. We in the church have to stop being the butt of the world's jokes. The church is not the world's punchline. The church ought not to be the world's laughing track. We do not exist to entertain or amuse the world. We exist to evangelize the world. We in the church must stop setting ourselves up for ridicule, mockery, priority, and scorn. In other words, we have to stop giving the world material to work with. They may want to make jokes and write satires about who we are and what we're about, but the church has to stop writing their material. I know you know, this is not a game. This is not a joke. We have a mission. We have a serious assignment. We have something. We've heard something. We've seen something. We've felt something. We know something. We're on our way somewhere. A charge to keep we have to serve this present age. We must be about God's business. I pity the person who in times like these is indecided, conflicted, and uncertain about what you know and what you see. These disciples saw Jesus riding into town on that donkey, and the very sight of Jesus resonated with their spirit, and it caused them to rejoice. It caused them to praise God. We've seen God moving in the church, in the world, in this country, and we still can't decide. All this preaching, praying, and praising, and you still can't decide? Stop praying. Come on in here. Get involved. Say something. Do something. Be something. Take this for free. Your indecision is your decision. Your silence speaks volumes. Your indecision is your action. Your neutrality is a side you take. There was that moment in the conversation when Cat Williams challenged Shannon Sharp about being clear about which side he was on. Cat said, Shannon, you played for the Denver Broncos. You didn't like the Dallas Cowboys. Shannon responded, yeah, but I didn't hate all of the Cowboys. Cat pushed back. Yeah, but you were clear that you weren't on the same team. You were on the other side. Oh, how I like that. I have some friends and associates and family members, and you do too, who are on the other side. We don't play for the same team. Spiritually speaking, we wear a different uniform. We have a different agent. We have a different management company. I don't hate or even dislike them, but when I'm around them, hanging out with them in the crowd, with them, I need them to know which side I'm on. And I don't know how you feel about it, but I don't mind that the other side knows that I'm a believer. I don't mind that the other side knows that I'm a preacher. I don't mind that the other side knows that I'm a child of God. I don't mind that the other side knows that I go to church, prayer meeting, and Bible study, that I get up early every morning to be on the 6 a.m. Prayer call. Those of us on God's side have a set of core beliefs that we are guided by. We know what we believe and why we believe it. We believe that God is loving and compassionate. We believe that God is just and equitable. We believe that God is not a human, so God cannot lie. We believe that God is too wise to make a mistake and too loving to do anything wrong. We believe that God is a promise keeper. If God said it, God is going to do it. We know where we stand and why we stand there, even when everything in the world is turned upside down, even when in a crowd, when no one is watching you, you know whose side you're on. Maynard H. Jackson, the first African-American elected to the office of mayor in a major city, had a code of conduct for the attorneys who were a part of his firm. Mayor Jackson said this: if you can see the line between right and wrong, you are too close to the line. As the people of God, we should not be trying to get as close as we can to the other side without going over to the other side. We shouldn't be trying to see how much we can get away with and still be saved, still call ourselves Christian. It does no good. It does not help. And it will not change a thing if you remain silent and docile while the other side speaks up. Your character, your integrity, your spiritual acumen is your superpower. You must use it for good. If you're going to be saved, sanctified, and filled with the precious Holy Ghost. If you're going to be a Christian, be a Bible reading, Bible carrying, Bible believing, Bible doing Christian. If you're going to be a church goer, be a praising, praying, participating Christian. Don't straddle the fence. You cannot stand in the middle of the road, hedge your bets, dance with two partners at the same time. It's not that hard, but you must decide God's side or the other side. When the political leaders saw Jesus riding into town, they began to plot and plan for Friday. When the religious leaders saw the procession following Jesus, they tried to stifle and silence the noise. They appealed to Jesus to tell the followers to be silent. Jesus responded, I couldn't make them stop even if I tried. That is really how powerful and purposeful praise ought to be for those who are on the Lord's side. Trying to keep a true child of God from praising God is like trying to stop LeBron from scoring, Beyonce from singing, Oprah from making money, Denzel Swag, Samuel Jackson from cussing. Even if he couldn't stop the praise. Human beings are not a part of, only part of God's side. If they're silent, the stones will break out. If they're silent, the trees will get involved. If they're silent, the lakes will roll. If they're silent, the flowers will bloom. Being on the Lord's side is not about you. It's about what God has done for you. Back in the day, in the Pentecostal church, the old folks used to raise this song in question. Where do you stand? Who's on the Lord's side? This is a God to follow. This is a God to worship. This is a God to praise. God knows the end from the beginning. God knows what's going on in Atlanta, in D.C., and in every place in between. God knows where you are. God knows what's going on in your life. Cheer up, my brother. Cheer up, my sister. We're going to be just fine. That's it. That's all. You're either on God's side or you're on the other side. The Pentecostal church went a little bit further in calling for testimony. In the middle of the song, they said, who's on the Lord's side? Then they said, you ought to demonstrate if you're on the Lord's side. And they said, stand up if you're on the Lord's side. Get up if you're on the Lord's side. Some folks would rather have houses and land. Some folks choose silver and gold. These things they cherish and forget about their souls. I've decided to make Jesus my choice. The road is rough. The going gets tough. The hills are hard to climb. I started out a long time ago. There is no doubt in my mind. I decided. I decided to make Jesus
and there is no doubt in my mind. to make Jesus, Jesus, oh, my choice.
Don't it just make you wipe a tear from your eye? They never said the road was gonna be easy. The road is rough and the going gets tough. Sometimes the hills are hard to climb. But you know what? I started out a long time ago. There's no doubt.
To make Jesus.
Come on and give him praise in this place, St. Philip. Hallelujah. Somebody today needs to make that decision. Which side will you stand on? I want you, no matter who you are, you felt the Spirit of the Lord moving on the inside of you right now. And you've made up in your mind that today is the day I'm choosing which side I'm going to be on. I'm not going to live my life in the middle of the road. I want to be on God's side. I want to invite Jesus into my heart. If that's you, I want you to come to this altar right now. Make your way here. If you're looking for a church home and the Lord has spoken to your heart, maybe you already know the Lord, but you're looking for a church home and the Lord has spoken to your heart, for you to make us a part of your family, I want you to come. Come on. Last but not least, you need prayer for your situation. If you need prayer, I want you to come and make your way to this altar. And as you make your way, come knowing that God will take care of all of your needs. Will you come? When they sung this song in my home church, they would say, come give me your hand and give God your heart.
Long time ago.
There is
no doubt in my mind. I decided to make Jesus my shore.
It's decision making time. I don't want you to be shy. Even if you're up in the balcony, I don't want you to be shy. You see, you got to understand the reason why we can get happy singing this song, because we've lived it out. We started out a long time ago. There is no doubt.
There is no doubt
in my mind.
In my mind,
I've decided.
To make Jesus my joy.
I want y'all to sing it again, because you saw it's not a bed of roses. It's not always easy. That's why we sing it.
You know the road is rough.
The going gets tough.
The going gets tough.
And sometimes those heels.
And the heels are hard to climb.
But I gave my heart to him and I started out. When did you start?
A long time ago.
There is no doubt.
There is no doubt.
I've decided to make Jesus.
To make Jesus my Lord.
I'm going to give you one more chance. I would not want you to walk out and miss what God is doing right now at this altar. I don't want you to miss the hand of God moving in your life right now. And there's about three people in this building right now. You feel like you're about to explode. That's how much you feel God moving in your heart. Don't ignore the move of God in your heart right now. Will you come? Will you come? If you're scared or you don't want to walk by yourself, grab somebody by the hand and say, I need somebody to walk with me. But I've got to go. Come on, clap on that. Come on, clap on that. And they're still coming. And they're still coming. And they're still coming.
You know the road is rough. And the going is tough. And the hills are hard to climb. Hey, I started out a long time ago. And there is no doubt in my mind. I decided to make Jesus my choice.
Pastor, we have this morning coming for rededication, rejoining Tion Marcus. We have Eric Gaines, who's coming this morning to join. And then we have Sister Bessie Lee, that just gave her life to Christ. One more. We have Tyler Jackson coming for salvation and baptism.
Yeah. Come on, St. Philip, you can do better than that. Come on, celebrate the Lord in this place. Celebrate the Lord in this house. Come on, clap your hands and give God praise one more time. Yeah. I give it up for this preacher this morning. Come on, give God praise. Dr. Carolyn Knight. And we give God praise for her, and she has to fly home to bury a family member, so we lift her up. And we would lift her up on every side, that God will continue to strengthen, bless, and keep her. Keep her heart, her voice, her mind, her spirit.
Yeah.
Keep her life, that she can carry the gospel every place that she goes. In Jesus' name. Come on, clap your hands one more time. I'm gonna be singing that song all week long, I'm telling you. I'm pulling it back up on the stream so I can watch it again. Give it up to this choir one more time. Praise the Lord. Our young people, don't forget about our young people over in the flag immediately following service today. I want to invite you to come on and participate in it. And again, all of our events for this week, I want you to be a part of it. This was just a kickoff moment as God continues to open doors and allow us to walk in all that God is speaking to us in this season of life. And the people of God said, amen. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Of our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ, the love of God, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide with each of you now, henceforth, and forevermore. And we all responded by singing.